My presentation question focuses on my hypothesis. Does the use of science improve the average footballer? The initial idea. My initial idea is to base my project around my passion, and my passion is football. It is well known that an average footballer can be developed, achieved more by the use of science. Over the next few slides, I'll be focusing my research on factual information on how science has developed the game of football in a positive way. I'm lucky to have connections with Toby Olave, who had to retire from football at a young age due to an unexpected heart attack. As I look further into his situation, it becomes more apparent that medical science may have helped to prevent this, and I'll talk more about this later. Human body and fitness. The human body is estimated to be made up of approximately 37.2 trillion cells. 65% is oxygen, 18.5% is carbon, and 10% is hydrogen, 3% nitrogen, and the rest is a combination of several other elements. It's proven that players with a high oxygen intake have higher endurance levels. Professional football fitness coaches monitor a player's maximum oxygen consumption before, during, and after a game. This is called the VO2 test. The VO2 test involves physical effort sufficient in duration and intensity to fully work the aerobic energy system to reach the VO2 max. This is found when the oxygen consumption remains at a steady state despite an increased workload. Let's take a look at it.
Sound cable's behind you. Sound cable.
Attention and CO2 production to determine all these values. And from that, you can help set your target rate training zones. The best way to use this is as a change over time measure to determine how your workout plan is going, if you're getting better, whether that's running, CrossFit, any sort of cardio-based exercise. The protocol for this test is you choose a speed where you're comfortable, but not too comfortable, and every minute you're going to increase the incline on the treadmill. Our goal is to max you out in about 10 minutes so that you're not running at too high of an incline, and then your oxygen consumption gets to that full max of the recovery max. During the test, we're graphing the heart rate, so your body's response to the increase in exercise intensity, along with your VO2 relative to your body weight, and liters per minute of ventilation during the test. Here we're measuring a variety of variables. The graphs here are showing the heart rate throughout the test, and then this is the VO2, so your oxygen consumption relative to your body weight, and then your ventilation, so how many liters of oxygen and airflow you're moving per minute.
In amateur and semi-professional football, the VO2 test is not yet used, but coaches can estimate a player's VO2 max by a simple equation. Maximum oxygen intake measured by 15 times your heart rate max divided by your heart rate max. The problem with the VO2 test is that the equipment needed is expensive and is rarely available to the average footballer. But knowing a simple equation means you can still work out your VO2 max, although it is not as accurate. Equipment. Football has flourished in England since the 8th century. Games are normally violent and disorganised affairs with any number of players. The first purpose-made balls were simply inflated pig or sheep's bladder, knotted at one end. Today, footballs are made from level patches sewn together in a design based on the Buckminster rule, consisting of 20 hexagonal and 12 pentagonal surfaces, which are sewn together and inflated to make a near-perfect sphere. Once you have a near-perfect sphere, you need to know how to kick it. This is where the skill comes in. And as it turns out, science has a prominent role in nurturing this skill. Using high-tech materials and scientific developments, the optimum ball has been created. It's fast, flight accurate, waterproof, and transfers all the kicking force to the ball without absorbing energy, and it's also safe to head. Science prevails in clothing too. A materials science company from the UK, D3O, has teamed up with a sportswear company to develop smart clothing that is both flexible and rigid. This means the goalkeeper gloves can be made to flex when stretching to save a vital penalty and immediately stiffen when the ball strikes. This intelligent material gets its qualities because of the way the material works on a molecular level. Molecules are free-flowing under the normal circumstances as they have time to move over each other, allowing the material to be soft and flexible. Upon impact, the molecules are temporarily cross-linked with each other, transforming the material into a stiff state. In addition to absorbing energy from the impact, as soon as the impact is over, however, the molecules unlink, returning them to the original free-flowing state. This helps lessen the impact and therefore injuries. The material has also been used to make shin pads that can reduce the amount of force transmitted to a player's leg by up to 70%. But the most obvious impact on science on players is in their boots. Beyond the fancy styling, the majority of money is invested in technologies to protect the metatarsals and ligaments, add power, stabilise momentum, and combat the effects of water, mud, or sweaty feet on performance. Today, companies such as Under Armour, Nike, and Adidas take this further by investing more into stability, protection, and speed. The science behind the boot can provide a critical difference between a boot that performs well the first time you lace it up and one that leads to blisters on your skin leading towards an early bath. I found some boots that even have their own brain. A data chip which measures the wearer's performance, including the average speed, maximum speed, number of sprints, distance covered, and a distance at high intensity levels. Data from the sensors can be transmitted to a smartphone, tablet, or computer. Shirts have also changed throughout the years. Companies are utilising science to develop shirts that help players to move quicker and easier. For example, the New England kit and AIDS performance by regulating players' body temperature over the course of the match, using a combination of dry fit technology, able to position cooling where players need it most. Night dry fit technology pulls moisture away from the skin to the outside of the garment where it evaporates quickly. Laser cut ventilation holes are engineered mesh in key areas to allow increased breathability and airflow across the skin. I think that the science behind the clothing plays a big part in footballers' choice on what they want to wear. Scientifically developed products. A large proportion of your body is made up of water, so fluid is essential to keeping your body working normally at both rest and during exercise. When you exercise, your body sweats to keep your body cool, but fluids can be replaced or dehydrated may occur. Sweat also contains electrolytes like sodium, which water alone cannot replace. Question: are sports better for hydration than water? In answer, the addition of both carbohydrate and sodium to a sports drink helps the body absorb more effectively. Another question: glucose drinks are used by footballers during and after a game to help them perform better. But is this true? Answer: sports drinks are scientifically formulated to tackle two key causes of fatigue and exercise, dehydration and a reduction in the body's carbohydrate stores. Food and many drinks provide energy for your muscles and brain. A well-balanced and planned diet that meets the needs of your exercise session can have a positive impact on your performance. I researched food and drinks available to everyone that could help performance, and there are lots of which can be available bought in the supermarket. For example, venison steak can boost recovery and power. Mackerel burns fat, broccoli helps vision, Beetroot juice boosts energy, green tea can aid focus, and almonds fuel workouts. Broad beans are known to aid awareness, and blueberries aid recovery. Players look for a way to gain their advantage over their opponents, and plyometrics is a method of training which helps gain the disadvantage. Using plyometrics is one of the most effective ways to increase explosive speed and power. Research has shown that the muscles stretch before contraction will contract more forcefully and rapidly, and that is basically what plyometric exercises do. They stretch the muscles and rapidly and then immediately demand a powerful concentric contraction. Let's break their last sentence down with a practical example. Allow anyone to stand up. And try jumping off the ground without first bending your knees. These are muscles that will contract forcefully a split second later to produce a jump. The shorter and more rapidly the downward movement or pre-stretching phase is, the more forcefully the muscle groups can contract and hence lift off. When kicking a football, there's contraction in the calf muscles of the lower leg that stays on the floor in order to keep you stable and prevent falling over. And a concentric contraction in your quadriceps, the front of your upper leg, as you stretch out your leg to kick the ball. This YouTube video shows simple exercises that anyone can do at home. These exercises here are plyometric design, and they work the quadriceps and the calf muscles, and they're really good for helping mobility and footwork as they become more agile. Toby Lovie. Toby Lovie is a retired footballer who previously played for an English Championship football club, Millwall, Swedish side Ljungskile SK, and finally, Eastern Premier Division side, Metropolitan Police FC. Toby joined Millwall as a schoolboy in 2002, and he was enrolled in an academy in 2010. It was just over a year later that 17-year-old Lovie made his first team debut while still on tour in Ireland and was awarded a professional contract a year later. During the spring 2013, Toby Lovie was signed for Swedish Superettan side, Ljungskile SK, on a 2-year contract. Toby then returned to England. While opting to play for one Premier League side, Metropolitan FC, scoring 11 goals in 16 games. This would prove to be Toby's last club in his career, after experiencing several cardiac-related episodes on the pitch. On the 15th of October 2013, Toby suffered a near-fatal collapse on the field of play. During a friendly game, after being rushed to hospital and undergoing a barrage of medical tests, it was discovered that his heart had stopped beating for a period of 10 seconds. Upon further testing, He was advised to stop playing professional football. On his 20th birthday, he had heart monitor placed in his chest to pinpoint the cause of his problems. In April 2014, Toby suffered another collapse at his home, and he was found lifeless on his bathroom floor. He was resuscitated and rushed to hospital. The heart rate monitor recorded that Toby's heart had stopped on three occasions for a period of 1 minute. It has from this information that doctors diagnosed HCM, which stands for hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. And Toby underwent a second operation to implant a pacemaker to remove the heart monitor. I have been lucky enough to interview Toby about his collapse and to see what could have been done to diagnose his heart problem sooner. Please watch the interview.
If it doesn't play, it's perfectly okay for you to just give us a summary of what you were able to get from your interview.
How'd you go out? In my
Right.
In my what's that?
Yeah, it's not right. Try it again.
I basically, what I asked him is, I was in Bexley Heath in the Marriott Hotel, and I asked him a few questions, and I asked him, obviously, what happened preventing him from playing football, and he said he had a number of heart-related problems, and that he had a heart attack on the pitch, playing for Met Police, and I also asked him about how they think he could have been prevented. And they said he had a heart scan when he was 15. He said if there was more in depth into that, then that could have been found sooner. I asked him what his foundation is about, because he has a Heart for More Foundation, and he says it's basically about bringing life back into the kids who sort of had these problems. So I thought that was a really good idea. And I asked him if you could have done anything more, or if doctors, if you could have gone back and done anything to what doctors could have changed or done, and he said nothing, because he said that what he's doing now is much more fulfilled, and he's done a lot better with it. So that was basically it. So from what you can see, Toby feels there's more scientific testing being done, conducted on him at younger age. Physical evidence of my hypothesis. I wanted to test my hypothesis by the use of science, and that it can improve the average footballer. I was able to do this by going alongside a training session of 14 mixed ability 7-9-year-olds, using a piece of equipment that measures how hard a player can kick the ball, without speaking to them about the scientifically improve their effort. I let all the players go strike the ball in the goal. This was scored in miles per hour, and the results were varying. I sat down next to the players and spoke to them about the correct scientific techniques used in kicking the ball. This included non-kicking foot by the ball, head over the ball, using a part of your foot to kick the ball, having a good run up, use all your power in your legs from your hips, and strike the ball through the middle. From my results table, you can see that 14 children, 11 players got better on the second time than their first. Two players got a lower score, and one player got exactly the same. Knowing the players that didn't improve, I think that this is because they did not listen to me when I explained what was needed to improve. In my opinion, I believe that the use of science does improve the average worker. This is because from the results I gathered throughout my project, has become more apparent that this use of science is used in the game, and it offers an advantage over their opponents. From my studies, I believe that science can be used to help football throughout all levels. Toby is a great example of this. If he had been offered heart screenings and more scientific tests on his body, he would have known more about his condition for longer and more could have been done about it. Thank you very much for listening to my presentation.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay. You said that, just one question from me. You said that steak can boost your power recovery.
Yeah.
How?
It's the protein in the steak that helps. It gets the recovery sooner, so I guess the red blood cells quicker, which helps boost your power. That's in the process, and when that's where you use most of your heart.
That's it. Thank you.